be so bold. Too many on my team for you to act so mean. You say you wanna go and have fun, but you ain't the only one. If I ring, don't let it ring too long, or I'm gone. I got Aisha waiting, Aisha waiting. All the issues waiting on me.
What is good? This is Teddy D back with another episode of the Why Not Podcast. As always, you can reach out to us on Twitter at Teddy_D_. Feel free to email at thewhynotpodcast@gmail.com. If you feel like you're in a great mood, please go to iTunes or whatever respective vehicle that you listen to podcasts and leave the best review that you can. And if you do, I'll see it. I will praise your name to the heavens, and I may even mention it on the show because we appreciate it. Also, please feel free to check out the other show that I'm happy to be a part of, and that is the Black Astronauts Podcast. As of now, we are running a Patreon campaign to get our fearless leader, Aaron B., into an Ewok outfit.
Choose your own destiny.
That's valid, actually. That's better than I could do. So that is going to be by Dragon Con, September 1st through 4th. And if you are in the area of Atlanta, we are planning a really epic meetup, which we'll talk about a little later. So, yeah, Black Astronauts. So today, family, we got a couple firsts, actually. These are not two gentlemen that are showing up on the show for the first time, but they are helping me break in a new corner in my house that we are using to record an episode of the Why Not Podcast. So you're pioneers in a certain way, but
you got a nice setup, Teddy. I'll just tell you.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it. So listen, here's the thing. These guys, you know them well if you are in these podcast streets. I will start with my brother to the right that I am happy to be a part of on another show that we do, and that is called the Wrap Up Show. The Wrap Up Podcast is where we, myself, Lish from Unscripted, LJ from the Potluck,
shouts out,
and of course the homie Spirit G from the G Spot Network, about 15 different shows.
Right.
And this man who made his maiden voyage into podcasting on the Why Not Podcast.
Right, yes, sir.
He came in and he spit the knowledge with not only LJ one episode, yep, but you were on one of the higher downloaded shows, the Politics Podcast. Uh-oh. With Borjo and,
that's right,
and Lish as well. So we decided to pull him in on the Wrap Up Podcast, and he is turned from the rookie to kind of the sage old guy that knows exactly what's going on from the books as well as the show. So listen, he's a father. He's going to be a busier father here in a little bit. Husband, educator, and just all around great dude. I want to listen, show some love to my homie Pack. What's going on, man?
What is happening, podcast family? Great to be here.
Yeah, man, it's good to have you back. It's
love
good to have
the
you
summer,
back, brother.
Free time.
It's kind of amazing, isn't
right? It's a beautiful feeling.
Yeah. Shout out to my educators that actually have a chance to live a life sometime in the summer. So yeah. And if it were just Pack, it'd be a great show. But we decided to call up the bat phone. And we just like, listen, we need another vet in this, as Spirit says, the Jelly Fam in the KY podcast streets. This man, you've heard him on shows such as Versus, and he has his own show, a vehicle that we are all a fan of called the OAF.
Shouts out to the crew.
Indeed, OAF Discussions. Born in the city of Lexington, but he read the writing on the wall. And he said, "You know what? A little was a little better. Let me segue over there."
Leave it.
This dude is
it's all about the real.
From the bottom of the hill, Louisville Park. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, listen, we just lost all chill.
They played in the club last Friday,
and everyone still went crazy.
Anybody listening, please download the Get Down Click, Louisville.
I got to talk about this when we end this. The intro. I got to talk about this.
But one of the leaders of the OAF Discussions, my homie Brent, what's going on, man?
What's good, everybody?
Yeah.
Thanks for having me back.
Hey, thanks for being here, sir. Thanks for being here, man.
Sit beside the man, the myth, and the legend.
Oh, wow.
Do we call it a legend? Because I ain't much of a myth.
Right. It's like the myth is, I heard Teddy had a good credit score. Like, no.
I'm enjoying the feng shui here.
Yeah, man. No, this is actually a good setup. Shout out to my rib who suggested the setup. So it's working out well.
Yeah, she's a smart woman.
Indeed, man. So, gentlemen, I mean, let's talk about, before we really get into some topics, how has life been going? Summer for you? How's that been going thus far?
It's good. You know, I mean, like you said earlier, us educators, we get all that flack. Like, oh, y'all get 3 months off. And no, we get 2 months off.
Man.
And as hard as we go for the other 10, like, we need this decompress. You need a reset button to come back and do it again. So it's great that to get this time. And also for, you know, my daughter to be born in the summer so I can get the room ready, get all that anxiety out, all these sleepless nights, like all this 5 a.m. gym visits, you know, like all this stuff that I got to get done.
I like how you slid that in there.
Hey, bro. Today was the first 5 a.m. gym visit, but we're trying to start a pattern.
Nice.
5 a.m.
Nice.
Right.
Shit, when you're be at work at 7, you got to figure out how to make it work. True. So I'm trying to develop the routines, but it's love, you know.
Valid.
Summer's great.
Valid, man. That's dope. And we're going to get into one of your other passions here in a second, but Brent, man, talk to me about life, man. The show is really progressing well.
Yep.
And
thank you.
I feel like you, Gary, man, we ain't forgot about Jacob, man. Listen,
we ain't.
Jacob's somewhere in these streets, you know?
Yo, he's doing good things. Like,
good.
As long as he's quiet, you know, good things are happening. So,
all right, that's what's up.
Like, I've been checking on his birthday. It was actually yesterday. So
okay. All right, well, happy belated, man.
The weekend, you know, celebrated with him.
All right.
Everything's been good, but he's good.
And the homie Shayna, can't forget about her too. She's doing really well on the mic.
Yes, she's come a long way, and she keeps me in line, I guess. She's the one that tries to check me.
That's
and,
right. Who's going to check me?
Task.
Well, Shayna, actually.
I mean, she tries. She tries. But right. It's kind of like being LeBron against whoever. I'm like, I'm going to get my triple.
Oh, man. Oh, shots fired. You know, that's what's up.
I'm Durant, you know, in the final. Like, I'm going to get my buckets.
Still
like,
hurts.
This is happening.
Still hurts, yeah. As a
too
LeBron
soon.
Stand. Yeah.
Too soon. My man.
But
my
I get it.
We'll
I mean, that should have happened.
I mean,
you know.
But let me digress.
Yeah.
Life is good. Like,
good.
Summer's going good. Work is smooth.
Yeah.
Family reunions. I got to see my actual family that I haven't got to see in 15 years.
That's what's up.
I took my cousins out on the town of Louisville.
Okay.
They played Louisville.
Hey.
I got to see my cousin's face because they're from Texas and Alabama.
Sure.
Maryland, everywhere.
Yeah.
And they was like, what's going on here? Plus, they clubs close at like 1:32.
Nah,
we out to 3:34.
Four, baby.
I see them getting the little droopy eyes, sleepy.
Yeah,
and
like, nah,
it's
like, we got another couple hours. Come on.
Swag surfing time.
Say, put some Red Bull in that cocktail. Yeah, keep on pushing.
That's right. Come
I don't
on.
Think I got them back to like 5 in the a.m. We went to Qdoba.
I was about
got
to
some food.
So, this is amazing to me. I have a normal job, and then for my second job, I guess I can let the podcast. So we're in the, thinking about moving to another place, and I'm just like, let me just, you know, I work 4 days a week. I got some extra time, so I started driving for Lyft.
Okay,
it would have been Uber, but anyone who reads the news realizes, you know, if you put that with my political beliefs, feel free to
gotcha.
Figure out why I went with Lyft. So, but I was out this past weekend, and for one, it was a good time. It was Pride Week here in Louisville, and I'd never been out during Pride Week.
It's something different.
Yo.
It's different.
It was
packed.
Cracking. Yeah. Like I...
We was on Barstown Road.
I mean, listen, like, it was crazy. Everybody was nice that I gave a ride to. Just, you know, good people, man. So
at concerts at the Belvedere.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that was it Carrie?
Carrie Hilton.
Yeah.
That's right. She came.
Was at the Belvedere. I didn't realize it either. We left to go to Barstown that she was performing. We were like two blocks away.
Yeah, man. That and then the other big thing, YouTube came to town.
Gave a ride to somebody to go to the YouTube concert, made $60.
Yo, lovely. It was crazy.
It was a good night.
It was crazy. I'm telling you, man. I'm telling you. But I say that because you mentioned Qdoba. I had no idea there was a Qdoba that opened past 11.
24 hours.
Amazing.
On the weekend.
Amazing.
They serve breakfast too.
Like, boom. Mind blown.
They serve breakfast.
I've heard about it. I've never actually been, though.
Let me tell you.
Yeah?
Do it.
Okay.
Like that.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, you got to threaten me with a good time. I'm in that, man.
They got queso in the morning.
Oh.
4 a.m.
Because I'm just saying.
Sit
down on the patio. Like I think, sit outside.
I think us talking about it, I just gained 2 pounds.
Right.
But
it was worth it.
Yeah.
It was
I'm happy. So it's okay. It's all right, man. So that's dope, man. So the shows have been going well. Pack.
What up, bub?
Wrap up, man. Like, talk to me about the stride that you hit. And, like, I got to say, you know.
He's MVP.
Well, yeah, I'm proud of my guy because, you know. Listen, I brought him in, it's not like I brought him in with anybody else who was new to the mic. And you not only held your own, but, I mean, the slander was so good. It was so good.
Well,
shout out to LJ.
So good. I was a little nervous when I got a tweet back. I was like, I don't know what's about
what
to happen.
Gonna go down.
Like, I don't know what's about to go down. Like, he looks like he's coming for people's throats. Like, all day.
Once Lish put me up on game on the Jamaican air horn, it was just like, all right, let's let it run. And this is something we're going to talk about a little bit later. But this notion of once you develop your confidence, you know, not hubris, you know, you don't have to take it too far, but believing in yourself and what you're doing. And on those shows, like you figure out how to play your part and then you figure out how to play other people's parts to piss them off too. Sometimes,
that's right.
And like you figure out how to get, you know, engage it in such a way that, like I much shout out to you for getting me into these podcast streets.
No, man, I'm happy to do it.
I will say to anybody listening that if you feel like you have a voice and there's something you need to get out, get it out in this way, because it's a perfect avenue, especially with good people around you.
Absolutely. And I think one of the themes of the shows that we talk about a lot, you know, why I'm such a big advocate for podcasting is it is therapeutic.
100%.
It is therapeutic to be able to turn on the mic and process some of your thoughts that you're not even all the way through yet. But when you turn it on, you got some good people to bounce things off of. You're able to listen at the same time and you know, turn around and make something good, man. I laugh because with podcasting, it is, I use this analogy on another show, so I won't dwell on it too much, but I was talking about, I won't even use that one. It's such a random thing.
You're not gonna drop it now?
I can't do it.
You're not gonna drop it.
No, you're right. So there's just a difference from actually listening to the podcast to actually doing them. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. So the analogy that I was using was House. You guys ever watch that show?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Dave Matthews was on there once, and he was a guest. He was a guest star, and he was playing a musical genius that was severely autistic.
Okay.
So they were trying to study him, figure out what was going on, what was wrong with him. So they gave him a brain scan, and they played music for him while he was laying down, and they didn't see anything special happening. And then they were like, oh, well, why don't you just pretend like you're playing the piano? And after he did that, then they saw everything lighten up in his head and, you know, all the colors going crazy. And like, to me, that's what podcasting is. Right. You have the ability to listen to any podcast that you want. You're just like, nah, I disagree with this. I would do that. But then when you turn it on and you actually start to do it, you realize like, oh, okay, this is a little different. This is a good different, but it's a little different.
I mean, look at the two shows we did. So, you know, the wrap up does Walking Dead and then does Game of Thrones.
Mm-hmm.
Game of Thrones, we are so charged for it, and it's banger up top banger. Like every episode, we're like, wrap it up. Like
this is
Walking Dead turns into a labor of love. And And that's fine. You know what I'm saying? Like, we still do it because, but we don't do it because we're so invested in Rick Grimes. We do it because we enjoy getting together and being able to rap for a few hours.
Right.
And to have that as an adult to separate from all the other crap that you got going on in your life that could bog you down.
Yeah.
Like, I could be so frustrated at Walking Dead, but to get it out with y'all and laugh through it.
Yeah.
Like, it's a good reset and it's a good pause to be like, man, just pragmatize everything. Everything's got its place.
No, I completely agree. It, to me, I gotta say, I don't know if I would. Yeah, I might have checked out of The Walking Dead.
You did. If it, a couple times. Stop that. He was watching football. He was watching Boise State. It was a high school game on in Nevada. Like, I'm sorry.
You know what
y'all talking about? I was like, what's happening?
I was completely transparent, though. Like, I'm just like, yo, this is.
But I will admit,
this is tough.
With the lame of the week or lame of the month.
Yeah.
Cause you'll get a tweet from me every time. Like, you're gonna get my lane.
Brent Panther strong on Twitter. Man, once listen, we figured out those.
And for the record, let's say this publicly: we are going to have none other than Brent from OAF Discussions.
Man, you hear
as
this,
the
man.
First guest.
It's been said out loud and recorded.
That's
so we
right.
Make it
for this next season,
somebody's on there.
Man, I don't know why I didn't process Facebook. That you wanted to come on. So I got you, man. I promise.
I only love these things, you know.
Right.
Well, look, man. Both of y'all brothers keep up the good work, and I'm excited to see what's going to come next. You know, I know you got a lot on the plate right now, Pac, but. You know, the great thing is podcasts aren't going anywhere. So whenever, if ever.
All right, here we go. And I'm going to be done with this.
Yeah.
So y'all love to keep putting me on blast about when I'm going to start my show. All right. And I look at y'all and I look at how you grow in doing this. And I look at some of the things we talk about. Consistency.
Yeah.
Right. Having a voice that's, you know. Consistent, it's the same word again, but I ain't got time for that right now. I'm just gonna be honest. Like,
right.
If you're gonna put a show out, it's gotta be every Tuesday or every other Tuesday, bang, 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 because you've got loyal listeners. You can't play this game. And
do once a month.
Listen, so I hear you. I
once
do.
A month.
I'm just saying, every time it comes down to who's recording the podcast, I'm the first one to put the finger on the nose. Yeah. Like, not me. I don't wanna be in charge of production or anything. I just wanna get my voice out and walk away.
I get it.
You could be
it.
Like BTG.
Yeah,
Teddy.
Yeah.
Just hit him with
the Baylor's
A1 product, and then walk away for a little bit.
Because I gotta say, I don't know if he's listening right now, but I'm gonna be having a conversation with Baylor pretty soon. He's close to graduating. Like,
chess out.
You know, Baylor. You know, you ready, man? What are we doing? Like at this point, you just kind of living in the house with a doctorate degree, like. Why? What are we doing?
The Podfather is basically saying he's ready to make you a made man. So
I'm just saying,
you have to step up.
BTG.
I mean, because we know you got the skills.
Yeah. So, but I'll say this to you though, Pac. I hear you, but I talked about this. I don't know, sometime, but like here's my current feeling on the consistency idea with podcasting.
Right.
I mean, listen, if you've listened to the show for a while, you realize that I've had moments where I've had to step away. I couldn't be as consistent as I wanted to. But when I came back, I was ready. I was in it and it was good. But I'm to the point now where I've asked myself the legitimate question, why am I killing myself to make a show every week?
Right.
Like, why? And it comes down to the accepted group thought of you have to have it at X time every day. And not because that's the right thing to do, but because that's traditionally what has been done. You know what I mean?
Because we're coming out of a different medium. So you're used to a TV show coming new every Thursday at 8.
Right.
Like, it's, you're not going to catch NCIS Los Angeles randomly on Friday.
Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, and I'm just like, that doesn't apply. That just doesn't apply. And for me, it's been an adjustment of my mentality. Like, yo, what my main priority is quality. Mm-hmm. You know, make sure that I have great guests and great topics that we can, you know, chop something up. The consistency is there if you look at a larger time frame, you know, like it may not be. is that alternative facts? Is that alternative facts?
That's pushing
that's
it.
That's some hashtag news right there, bro.
So I'll throw this in here. So
Dr. Strange, time don't matter.
Right. Just this is what we do.
I tried.
What I've told some people that wanted to start podcasts is because their ideal is, I don't have time. I don't have time.
Right.
Yeah. One, who are you doing it for?
Right.
Yeah.
If you can't do every week, don't do every week, because you set your timetable.
Right.
So if you say once a month, then once a month it's going to be like Christmas for everybody.
True. Yeah,
whenever
true.
That drops on their feed, and they're going to be like, "Oh no, I gotta listen to that because it's dropping now."
Right.
If you give somebody a taste every week, then they'll just keep coming back every week. But you get to set when people get it, so you can always make it around your time. You don't have to be 1 week. Yeah. I'll be honest; like, I think we haven't been on. I don't think we recorded in like two weeks.
I think it's been two. Yeah.
I think the longest we went is like a couple months.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, I was jonesing for a little bit when that happened, because this is part of one of my outlets. But two-week break, life happens. There's, you know, holidays. People got things going on. I'm not tripping. Plus, nobody's knocking down my door like, hey. Well, I've heard a few people like,
Where we at?
What you doing? Y'all all right?
Yeah.
Anybody in the hospital? Like, they've been checking on me. So I realize we're making a little difference. We're getting a little buzz. But I'll be honest, if you can't do it every week,
hey.
Don't stress yourself out over it. 2 weeks, a month. I would say shoot for a month, and then work your way, like, whatever feels good. If you can drop two in a month, you know what?
There's even a couple of podcasts that I like that are like 5 or 10 minute podcasts.
Yeah,
like Check In, and I think the homie Elon White from This Week in Blackness. He they changed their whole format, and they're working on actually getting on TV, but. He started a new podcast called Daddy Game Proper, and it's just about him being a dad with his infant. You know what I mean? It's really good. But so listen, now you know why I'm excited, right? You get to hear from the two brothers that that I have on the mic, I'm really feeling good about the show. So we actually prepared a couple of topics for you. Give us a break. What we're going to do now is, if you turn your pages to 146, where the choir is going to come and have a selection. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, we'll take offerings. So,
church.
Thanks for joining us. And just give us a minute. We'll be right back with Brent from OAF and Acting Rapper. Welcome back. Thank you. God is good, right? Look at that choir. Thank you. And we're going to send around the second offering in a minute. So today, one of the things that we wanted to talk about is one of our favorite topics here at the Why Not Podcast, and that is how you can achieve growth in life in general. And some growth is a lot more painful than others. One of the key examples I have in my life is, it seems like it comes up every show, but shout out to Focus. When I tried my hardest to, you know, hit the crowd with a sexy voice, and you know.
Ayo, girl.
Yeah, and the women just weren't responding. And long story short, the audience laughed. I turned around. My group members were laughing. And I'm like, oh, this is what it's like to live the nightmare that everybody has. This is awesome. But from that, I learned, like, hey, the worst thing that could ever happen to me has already happened. And I don't mind getting up in front of people and speaking, because I'm like, how? It can't get any worse. Come on. Like, that was kind of the pinnacle. So we were throwing around some ideas this week, and this is one of them. You may refer to them as epic fails, but we'll call them painful life lessons, if you will.
Painful.
Painful life lessons. And as always, if you have any examples of these, just feel free to reach out on Twitter. And all three of us, have we given your information yet on Twitter?
RPAC1 for this guy.
Okay. LLCoolB22.
All right. And we're going to give it again at the end of the show, or you can look at the show notes. That'll be listed as well. So, Pac, you want to start us off with this wonderful and horrible journey at the same time?
All right.
It's funny. You know what I'm saying? Like, the older we get, the easier it is to look back at these sorts of moments and find the positives in them. Because when it was happening, the world was collapsing on top of us.
Oh, of course.
We were drowning in cement. Like, you weren't getting out.
Yeah.
All right, we go back to, like, 2000, graduating high school for me and Teddy.
Yep.
Okay.
And, like, whatever happened, I ended up going to Northern Kentucky University.
Shout out to the
Nothing
Norse.
Nothing wrong with NKU as a place.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I had plenty of money, so much that I was getting, like, a residual check the whole night.
Shout out to residuals.
Nice.
But
Pac's a smart guy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
When I want to be. But the way it all kind of went down is, so I wasn't going there, and then at the last second I had to, because I wasn't allowed to go to U of L by my parents. And so I go, I don't know anybody. First couple of weeks are literally sitting in the dorm on Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, crying myself to sleep, literally watching like Dateline 2020, nothing popping on campus, don't know anybody, am not the sort of person at 5 feet tall at 18 years old to be like outgoing to make new friends. And so the whole thing set me down a path of negativity, to the point that eventually I ended up joining a fraternity I had no business joining. And because I did that, stopped going to school like I was supposed to, because I was too busy trying to fulfill their wants, needs, like play that role.
Right.
Lost my identity is really what it comes down to. So Pac, who went from $6,000 check and residual money, went to the second semester owing full tuition, dorm, everything. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Gotcha. My first semester GPA was a 0.9, and I had a 31 on my ACT. Like, my advisor was looking at me, and she was like, are you on drugs? Like, straight up, like, what are you doing? We have rehab people, but nothing on your paper matches what you've done here in 3 months. Like, I got kicked out of the dorms.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's a whole bunch of nonsense. So I end up with the fraternity bros in an apartment at 19 years old, first semester, second semester of college.
Right.
We get in, lights are on in the apartment. So we just move in, live life.
Yeah.
January, February, March, come in the crib. Hit the light switch, no lights.
Oh, no.
Like, look at the thermostat, it says 54 degrees or something. And I'm like, call the roommate, like, should I pay the bill? He's like, dude, what bill? And I was like, oh, you're right. What bill? Oh, crap. Hold up. We never called the electric company and put anything in our name in this apartment, did we? So we call the freaking apartment manager, and she's like, yeah, we got a bill for like $900 for your apartment. And so we told him to shut it off. So we called Synergy at the time, like, yo, what can we do? And they're like, you got a choice, you either pay in full or you pick one of them and we'll turn that one on. The gas bill for the heat was cheaper than the electric, so we paid gas bill.
All right.
And then for the next 3 months, we had no electricity. You see what I'm saying? So you got four 19-year-old boys that don't know, the teen frat boys, you see what I'm saying, living in an apartment with hot water, but no electricity. Have you ever made ramen noodles on a charcoal grill? Because I have. You see what I'm saying? Like,
I say I haven't. I can actually say I have not. I thought I was. This is life lessons, right?
This is real. This is
Northern is the same place where I had the first unhappy father that I was trying to date his daughter pull a shotgun in my face. Like, Northern is the same place where I decided it was okay for me to tell a teacher how I really felt about her class and failed it. You see what I'm saying? Like, Northern as a shell, like, I could go into all of these deeper, but everything I did up there was like, go left or go right. Right's good. nah, I'm going left. And I just kept going left.
Yeah.
And now as the 35-year-old adult, I look back at 18, 19-year-old me in that situation. I'm like, what were you? If I could go back in time, like, I was spending so much time, energy on trying to impress people that weren't worthy of impressing, because if I just would have been me, more than likely they would have been impressed by that.
Right.
So I'm trying to play a role, and I lost my identity, and I just let it spiral. Like, I was clubbing Thursday to Saturday.
Yeah.
Like, I might have been selling things I wasn't supposed to. Like, I went down a route that was not who I was at all.
Yeah.
And it took me literally, because we're going to talk about other things, like, all of that stunted my progression into adulthood 3-4 years easy, because it wasn't like 18 to 20 were those years that molded me and made me a man. I just wasted them, and then at 20 I had to pick up the pieces and figure that crap out. So by 23 I was where I should have been at 20, and realistically, looking at my parents and then looking at everything that happened up there that they don't find out about till days, weeks, months, years later, when you finally sit down and you're like, you screwed up. And I need you to understand that, Pack. You screwed up. And for me to be like, Mom, I know I did. Like, I'm already at that point because it was such an impactful lesson.
Yeah.
So, yes, my epic fail, and this is not to anyone going to college now, but make sure the college that you pick, because Northern's not a bad place, but make sure it's not right for right now, it's right for you in general. Because if it's not, there's a lot of stuff that'll just snowball off of that.
Now, that's real. I've actually never heard anybody say that, but that's a perfect way to explain picking a college. Not what you need today, but what you are looking forward to doing tomorrow.
Yeah, no, that's actually completely accurate. Completely accurate. And that's that wisdom that you wish you had at the time.
Yeah,
you know?
I wish I'd have ran into...
Right. Like, but only experience can give you that.
Oh, no.
Like that perspective.
Like, I needed like freshman year.
So
probably still being a screw up at that point.
You were seasoned then.
How young are you, youngster?
That's right.
Let's put it out.
That's right. It's okay.
29.
I figured it out.
We were right.
I was like,
I could have been a mentor.
I did the math. It was like 2000. I'm 06.
I feel like we were respectable at that point.
Y'all could have dropped these gems on me. Now, whether I would have listened to them or not,
that's just like
that's the other kicker. But I needed the gems.
That's just like from "Don't Be a Menace" while you're drinking your juice in the hood, and that scene where he's in jail. It's like, why didn't you call me, man? Why didn't you ever call me? He's just like, nigga, I didn't know you.
Right.
Like, I'd love to help. We just met.
All right. Hypothetically. Pull the guy by a scruff. That guy. Him right there. He needs it. Like, I'm pretty sure it was on me. Can I jump in
please,
with this?
Please, like, absolutely.
So, because... Pack, you told this story. I've now thought of two epic fails. I'll start with school, since we were already on that topic.
Yeah, I got one too. Yeah.
So mine was, I got put out of college.
Mm-hmm.
I got actually, kicked out, had to reapply, I felt like I was doing like what would be the equivalent of university drug deals. Like, I had to like deliver letters and folders and shake certain people's hands certain spots.
Right.
Like, I could only talk to specifically them. If they didn't show, I was never there.
Let me holler at this dean real quick.
Like it was like, I need you to make a run for me. Run this pack. Like, no pun intended.
I see what you did.
I didn't mean that. I can do better.
You will.
Yeah. But like, what I learned was, like, it was me freshman year. Like, a lot of things was going on. I'm pretty sure I was just a young dude, chip on his shoulder.
Yeah.
A little bit trying to fight the world, a little bit just trying to figure it out. And I was partying Monday through Saturday.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The good life. I went to U of L. I had 8 a.m. classes, 8 till... Like, I thought I could still do it because I was used to high school with the block scheduling. Like, I could just run them back.
Sure.
And I made that mistake because I had, like, all, like, math, chemistry, psychology. Like, I had all the serious classes back to back.
Yeah.
Only down the road did I figure out that I could take, like, ballroom dance.
I mean, we count, for sure.
You know?
Yeah.
But I came in speed school, so, they ask a lot from you, from speed school, things like that.
Absolutely.
And this is the weed out period. But I lost my way because it wasn't so much I was chasing women, because my brother, like, the day before I started college, or before he dropped me off, because, you know, we were chilling and everything, he was like, don't even try to get a girlfriend the first year. He was like, this isn't about that.
Yeah.
Make some friends, you know, have some fun.
Right.
But don't even look for a relationship. He's like, books is what you're here for. He imparted to me what?
I'm just saying, like, that's great knowledge to have at 18. But if somebody would have told me that, I would have been like, yeah, yeah.
No, no, that's okay. What I said. I was okay. Like, don't even worry about it. Like, I ain't even tripping. Like, I'm here for the books. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm here. Clearly, you leave me 5 minutes in a room and there's like three chicks, I'm definitely gonna slide up on one of them and be like, hey, what y'all doing later? What we doing? Y'all, what, just wanna say what hi. Classes?
Yeah, just wanna say hi.
Now I'll walk you over there. Ain't no problem. I ain't got nothing to do right now. So, I think I came out of school with like, I mean, that freshman year, I lost the scholarships, all that, and I think I came out with like a one something. The next year, the next semester, I got put out because I got put out in summer school. Actually, I found out that I was kicked out of school while I was taking summer school classes. I didn't raise my GPA high enough.
I got you.
But I had like a 3.0 something, but it wasn't high enough.
Yeah, speed school is no joke. No, yeah.
It's not. Yeah. And so that taught me a big life lesson because, one, I didn't have anywhere to live. Like, some things was going on in life. Like, that was a period where I was, like, sleeping in the car. Like, literally sleeping, you know, everything piled up in the car, sleeping in the car, taking showers at people's dorms, maybe going to a house of a family member who wasn't there, you know, getting in, taking showers, going back, doing my work. That made me realize that I had that moment, like, you messed up. Yeah. Like, I understood I was in a bad shape, but it was like, how do I fix this?
Fight or flight, what? Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm always going to be a fighter, so
yeah.
I had to, one, get back into school, and this is, my peoples didn't know. Like, they were like, what are you doing hanging around, this and that? And
I feel like that's a whole show that we could do one day. Like, the stuff we went through that our people really didn't know.
Yeah, like, I tested the water one day just from high school stories with my, like, my moms and a couple people. I was like, do you remember graduation night? Like, us going into graduation night? Like, literally gunshots was going over people's heads.
Yeah.
Before we walked across stage, like, jeez, the night before. Like, that's crazy stories. But this isn't the moment for that.
Yeah.
So there was that. It was like this epic fail of me being a person who should have passed every class flying colors. And I was tanking tests. I was, you know, not doing sleeping habits right. I was like partying, doing everything that typical
freshman,
you know, freshman does. Yeah. But I should have handled the business, and you know, there was other things, include like anxieties and things like that, because different things was going on in life. But it took me after that to really realize that now I'm doing this college for me.
See, that's
and as soon as that switch flipped, because I've always had like a chip on the shoulder, because there's been people that told me like, hey, don't even think about college, you can't do it. I ran into that in the school system, out of the school system, you know, people are like, you're gonna die before you make it to 18, this and that. Like, I've heard these things, and it was just like, am I gonna be what everybody thinks I am, or am I gonna do this for me? Like, why am I here?
In the words of a great philosopher, am I going to barbecue or am I going to mildew?
Yeah, yes. Who mildews? That's the question. Who mildews?
Nah, man, that's perfect, because just staying with the theme, even though mine was a little different.
Let me switch it up. I got another.
Well, I want to mention this one because I wasn't going to. I might as well. So,
how did you fail for it?
Yeah, that's right. Fail forward. Isn't that such a nice way to say such an epic fail? Fail forward. So here's a little history. I was really into music for a while. So always had a passion for it, but I had a passion for the behind the scenes stuff. So, you know, the writing, the arranging, like all that I love. And at the time, I wanted to learn more structure to what I was doing, just not, you know, meeting a group or working with someone and helping a song, where I just wanted more. So I went to the school in Orlando, Florida, by the name of Full Sail, Full Sail University. And Full Sail is a school that can teach you one of five things. So I went for audio engineering.
Okay.
So, you know, recording, studio, and you know, all that good stuff. Then they had live shows. So everybody who works the concerts, so, you know, I went to school with them. Animation, so, you know, all the Pixar stuff, movies, and then something else. I forget what the other
one was. I think I've heard of them because of animation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, they're an incredible facility and everything. So, you know, the music, so this was probably 2003 at the time. And I'm down in Orlando by myself. You know, nobody, not only from Louisville, but no one from Kentucky was down there with me. It was just, it was a completely different,
interesting.
It was a completely different experience. I'm immersed in this new culture. It's everyone that I was cool with was either from, you know, a big city like Detroit, Miami, Houston, like those were my people. So anyways, so school was cool, but you have opportunities and going to this school that are pretty awesome. So you know, you can have relationships with different record labels and people that are looking for you. They want to get in early because, you know, you're pretty high commodity for stuff you can do.
Right.
But I also had friends that were doing music. So shout out to one of my old friends. We don't really kick it now, so, you know, we fell out, but he's still a good dude. Rashad Briscoe, I'll say his name. We grew up together.
Oh, am I shouting him out like shouts out to him? Sure, or is the beef still happening?
I don't know. It's just, it's not a beef. Like, it's just,
shouts out.
You know, we just grew apart.
I mean, like, you got to know these things. Like, right. Like, is the beef still happening? Nah, I ain't going to say shouts out.
Nah, it's just, you know, silly stuff. So,
all right.
It wasn't over a woman, for the record. Anybody who's listening, it was not light. Over a woman.
You know?
No. G code, man. G code. I can only say so much. So, but
all right, keep it real. All right, let's move.
But then from there, you know, we were cool with some local artists that were doing different types of music. So it was cool. You know, we would introduce them to people. They would introduce us. You build relationships. That's one of the benefits of going to the school. So I got really into the promotion A&R side of music for a while, and with that came some really unhealthy living. So, like, you know, key example, we would leave to promote an album, and for some reason everybody wanted to promote their album in Panama City. Like, that was
for some reason.
Right? So we would leave Orlando, Winter Park to be specific, and go to like Panama City with all these different, you know, CDs, and we would have a goal, like, let's try to sell 100 CDs this weekend. Then after four clubs, a whole lot of partying, play ball on the beach, whatever. I think we sold about 20, you know.
Okay, sounds but, right.
But like, but we could still walk away and feel good because I got, you know, a song played in the club because I knew the DJ from something, whatever. But like that, I look back at that time without going into too many more details as, you know, not to get all deep, but like, yo, even when I wasn't really praying or really thinking at all about God, I'm like, yo, you have my back, because Jesus, like, I was out there living foul. Foul. Like, I just mean let me clean this up. All right, no, so I just mean
it's the chuckle that makes it better. Like, it's, yeah, it's everybody understands. It's,
yeah,
like,
everyone's like, you don't Teddy and foul. What, like,
but it's like,
didn't wash your hands after.
I know that Teddy. I know that Teddy. Everybody knows that side. Like,
yeah.
I get it.
No, everybody's got their moments, right? So, but I say that to say that was also a part of my life where I look back and the opportunities were endless of what I could have done and where I could have gone specifically from there. but I tricked it off partying. Right. You know what I mean? And I, like, that was more of a priority than serving an internship and you know, taking that job at such and such record label. Or
you did the superficial networking for a good night as opposed to the genuine networking that would have mattered months later.
Exactly. So
for the immediate gratification.
So,
which,
so
of
you
course,
know,
that's what teenagers did.
That's it.
So we all just did in our stories, right?
Like, yeah. I mean, literally, it's,
yo, that's
I can
it.
Do this, or I can be responsible.
It's like, I'm just saying.
Oh, yeah,
I'm just
saying. So, right. And then I'm gonna do it again tomorrow.
Call it the crew.
So yeah, I think that is a great way to sum it up. That all of us could actually go with four different stories on top of that to
for sure
to point it out, but. Just in general, that's one of the beauties of getting older, you know, and it's not something that's talked about a lot, but the experiences that you have make you who you are today. Right. And we wouldn't be where we are today if we didn't do some really dumb stuff when we were younger. and we could look back and be like, man, that's
I understand.
Yeah.
Can I drop one more?
Go ahead.
Yeah.
So this is maybe 4 years ago.
Okay.
What was it?
Is that, I don't know if the statute's of limitation. But go ahead.
No, you know, hey, shh, don't mention my name. But no, this was a little organization called Nucleus was doing entrepreneurship.
Okay.
Shark Tank was in town.
All right, nice. All right.
I can't remember the last time Shark Tank, like the big Shark Tank, was in town. We were hosting. I gave a elevator pitch in front of Shark Tank, part of this program.
Nice.
And like 200 people, some angel investors.
Yeah.
All that. I'm typically, most people know I'm pretty smooth. I can cover my own. I typically don't break.
Right.
Yeah, I forgot my elevator pitch 40 seconds into it.
Oh, man.
Like, literally total was working blank? The crowd. Huh?
Total blank?
Total blank in mid-sentence, though. Like, I was working the crowd. I had every, like, it was literally one of those moments I had everybody on eating the palm of my hand. Yeah. Eating out of my hand. I was like, I could see the money getting thrown at me. Like, this is happening.
Yeah.
Looked in, seen somebody I knew in the audience, and they had this look, like, for the first time in their life, they believed every word I would say.
Right.
And I'm talking about, I've known them to where they knew when the idea was an infant until I practiced it 1,000 times.
Yeah.
And for the first time, they looked at me and was like, who is this? Like, what is this? This is amazing. And I completely blanked.
Oh, man.
A dude on the front row, like, realized that I... like, literally forgot. He thought it was like a dramatic pause.
Yeah.
It wasn't. It was dramatic, all right. That was true. It was dramatic.
It was so dramatic.
But it was watching 200 faces go from lullabied in this story, this web, this moment, to being like woken abruptly, like, what the heck did we just...
Good catch.
What the heck did we just witness?
Yeah.
And this dude was like lip, like mouthing the words. I read his lips. And he ran back to like the last three words I said.
Yeah.
And I finished the rest of the thing. I got to applause, all that. The first angel investor thing they asked me was, what happened? What happened?
Yeah.
And from that moment was like an epic fail, because I've never... froze and just completely botched. Like, it's an elevator pitch in front of like real, like, these are people with real money, real ideals, real movement. Like,
right. What the great thing is, though, I mean, if they would have bid on your idea, like, you know, the more I listen to, the more research I do. Technically, I have, you know, I still have the business that we did the studio under. And I think about trying to scale it at some point, but I don't want to do it with an investor, because
you got to give up something.
Yeah. You not only the percentage, but the power and the suggestion. So I say that to say, like, whatever the idea was, you can still work at it and not have those people hanging over your head.
That's
just got to put a little bit more grease in there.
But investor, if you don't have the capital to make it happen, could be your base. You just got to figure out how to work the contract.
Yeah.
So that way you're still getting enough to make you happy, are still the better end of the deal, because you don't want to sell your idea for 70%.
I guess
you know what I'm saying, they get 70% of you.
All right, look, let's I caught myself because I was about to go into
my bad.
No. This is my wheelhouse.
I was like, my bad.
I love it. But no, you're right though. You're right. Like that's legit. So
I close up my thought.
Yeah.
Literally, after that moment, I had a moment. I thought to myself, I don't think I could fail in front of like anybody else worse than this.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I instantly was like, I wanted to either be a commentator. I wanted to be a what do you call it? Esports commentator. No. I wanted to be an esports commentator. Actually, like oddly enough, random. It was an esports commentator. No. And then I was like, I want to do podcasting.
Yeah.
This is actually after failing at that is when I wanted to become a podcaster.
Nice.
Because I was like, I put my voice out to 200 strangers.
Yeah.
Who don't care about anything I have to say before I speak, and I gave them an elevator pitch to woo them into my idea, to believe in what my idea is. Why can't I just get on a mic and talk to the void or my friends or a great company like yourselves?
That's true,
things
man.
Like that. So I think that was a pivotal moment for me.
Yeah.
I feel like that's the nuance in all these stories, though. It's like every epic fail we just talked about was derived in some sort of innate passion we had. Like, these fails that gave us these true life lessons weren't like, oh, I'm going to step out and do a polka. Like, I don't know nothing about a polka. Like, it's supposed to be bad.
Right.
It was something that we were expecting to thrive in easily.
Right.
And then it became more difficult. And then more importantly, it made us become more introspective, figure out what about ourselves we were screwing up / not giving full potential to hit that mark. Mm-hmm. And so to elevate yourself to hit adulthood, like, that's really the life lesson. Like, a failure is only a true failure if you don't learn nothing from it.
Sure.
Like, all of us took those lessons and were like, this is what happened to me? That should never happen to me.
Right.
Like, I don't care who I am. I don't care what your confidence level is. Like, when you can resolve an issue and say, that's so played out wrong for who I am, that's how you go to the point to move forward. Because like Brent just said, if that first 200 audience wouldn't have went well, and it didn't go well, but for him to still have faith in what he was doing, you don't move into podcasting unless you can grow from that.
Yeah.
What people do when they fail, they look at it and say, I'm not good at, I don't want to try anymore.
Right.
And what we all learned from our fails is because they were in things we were good at, and it's not about being good. It's not about being passionate. It's not about being intelligent. It's about putting all of it together in the timetable and the situation you're presented and maximizing that potential.
Say that.
Talk to
say
him.
Say that.
Talk to
him. Hey, it's summer break. I'm great teach. You know how I get. You know how I get.
I love it. I love it. Listen, I got nothing to say after that. So
I already got class.
Listen.
Doing a master's right now. So I already got class.
Pack over here having a master's. Class. I like it. So look, we're gonna take one more break and come back and finish strong. Thanks again. We got Brent from the OAF Discussions as well as Pack from the Wrap Up Podcast.
Woo-woo.
And myself, Teddy D. Just give us 1 second and we'll be back. Come on, choir.
He's back.
I said I'm geek and I'm fired up. All I want tonight is just get higher. Girl, you look so good, it's to die for. Ooh, that good, it's to die for. It's a secret society. All we ask is trust. All we got is love. Loyalty, loyalty, loyalty. Gone for Kenny now. My resume is real enough for 2 millenniums. A better way to make a way, stop defending them. I meditate and moderate all of my wins again. I'm hanging on the fence again, I'm always on your mind. I put my lyric and my lifeline on the line. And ain't no limit when I might shine, might grind. You rolling with it at the right time, right now. Only for the dollar sign.
Bad girl, ripping now. Swear, leaving now. On your pulse, I can see the M. Gas on the like it's premium. Hard on the down in the fast lane. Been a bad trip before any cash came. I'm established, tryna carrot. So my name run the Atlas. I'm a natural, I'm a red.
I'm a savage, I'm a I'm a king. Shimmy ya, shimmy ya, shimmy ya, rah. You can tell ya, he can meet me outside.
Yeah.
You can babysit him when I leave him outside. Ain't no other love like the one.
All right,
I know.
Welcome back. Choir did another beautiful selection. Thank you, babies. Continue to be great. So
where is Choir at?
Man, listen, we can't tell people all the secrets.
Okay. I feel
you. He's got a choir in the background, you know. Like, he's doing big things.
You know, I don't want to make people feel inadequate that they don't have a choir.
I got you.
Yeah, it's the whole thing. All right, so listen, in this part, Moody is the Podfather, not me. I'll give you all the history on Moody. Here
okay.
In a second. y'all not gonna have him come for me in a podcast room. But so
you already got beef. So what's another?
I was gonna say, Teddy don't do slander well.
Yeah,
safe to walk in the streets.
There we go. All right. So what if everyone listening? You ask yourself a question, and it's just like, listen, if you had the opportunity to go back into time.
No.
No?
I'm black.
All right.
What time period am I going to?
We need to talk about that.
We don't want to go to the 1600s. Is that what you're saying?
We don't want to go to the 1970s. What you mean, bro? We black.
We don't want to go to dinosaurs.
1700s is because it's getting.
All right, let's specify this.
Egypt, maybe.
Listen, like, well, I don't know, though.
If you're a slave.
I was going to say, like, you lifted one of them blocks for that pyramid.
Yeah, I'm not trying to be that.
If only you could figure out how they did that. Like, I love how they, how very smart people come to the explanation of it had been aliens for them to move those blocks and make pyramids instead of the brown people figuring out something.
Right.
Really,
they
really
have.
Smart. Like, come on, guys. So, so I digress. But if you could go back into your life,
mm-hmm.
not 1970s, right?
Okay.
And you had an opportunity to sit down and talk to your younger self. One-on-one saying, hey, self, let's go get a burger. I gotta tell you some things.
That's scary.
And you would say, I have the following advice for you as far as dating.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
What would you say to yourself?
Brent, you go first this time.
As we sit down and have a burger.
Yeah.
I would tell my younger self.
Thanks, older Brent.
All the girls you have crushes on them, forget them all.
Oh, man.
Don't even worry about them. They're nothing.
Wait. Okay.
Nothing. Move on to the chick that you're friends with.
Yeah.
That you really think that you can find better.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, work funny. With them because they're down for you all day and night.
Okay.
That would be the first thing.
Okay. All right.
I can come back with another one.
Yeah.
Forget. Because I've been curved by all my crushes.
Oh, man.
They were nothing. That was probably one of my most embarrassing moments, too. A crush literally turned me down at the locker, and my homegirl hyped me up and was like, go ahead and get that number, this and that.
Oh, but is
and
that a
she gave
girl?
Me, like, who are you?
Locked
the locker on me and walked off to the bus. Just complete diss.
Shout out to her responsibility, though. She did close the locker.
Let's steal her TIA.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, bump her. Bump right. My homegirl for setting me up for failure like that, because I think she knew. To this day, I think she knew.
Well, we joking, but he's making a very valid point there.
Yeah.
In high school and even in college, like, before you feel like you could really look at yourself and say, I'm a true adult man, like, you look at all of those past experiences and you look at how you were so impressionable to make it to validate it for someone that wasn't yourself. Like,
yes.
As Brent just said, like, there were plenty of great women in high school that were interested in him, but for whatever mindset didn't hit the level.
Right.
And so they didn't get any time. Like, that's all of our past. Like, we had a notion of who we were and confidence, arrogance, whatever. But it wasn't. It was insecurity. Because it really was more attached to, if I pick the wrong one, they gonna blast me for it.
Yeah.
Whereas if I pick the right one and it doesn't work out, at least I get daps for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And so that's, like, the big lesson I would tell myself. It's an extension. Like, have enough confidence in you to read people. Mm. And the people that are genuine with you, they're not genuine at that age for no reason. Like, at that age, everyone's ingenuine because you're freaking hormonal teenagers.
Sure, we don't know what's going on.
So the ones like, that are truly ride or, ride or die because they want a best friend that's a dude. Like, they're as insecure as you are, and they don't have the gumption to come strong.
Right.
And so we were so busy coming strong to the ones, like you said, to curve us at the locker or to say, you too white for me. Mm-hmm. I'm not dating you, but like to go through all of those angles as opposed to looking at the ones that were down for us every step of the way.
Yeah.
And we really could have grown with. Like,
shouts out to them.
No, I agree. I agree.
They were still a fan.
There it is.
That's right. I like what you're doing.
Teddy?
About yourself. You got to talk to your younger self.
You know what?
He's on stage again.
That's right.
Okay.
That's
Eastern right. High School, 1999. The lights fall.
There's one rose.
I'm talking to myself crying.
On bended knee, just hit number one.
What is he doing?
And Fusion is coming through, ready to perform.
You know what I would say? And this is
hey yo girl. He's gonna be like all the girls. No. You bring
I apologize
here.
To anyone listening. No, every time I go, hey yo girl, in my deep voice, it's not deep at all. So.
Blah blah.
Hey. I'm sorry.
All right, so here's what hey, I would girl. Say. Here's what I would say. I would and this is you know, don't get mad for what I'm gonna say. I'm just saying this, all right. I would come to my younger self and I would be like, listen.
Hold up, he just told us how we're supposed to feel.
I know.
Yeah.
But I wonder if he's going to call us lame or something. Because he already
Yeah, no, I'll come to my younger self and say,
it's for the lame.
Find Pack and Brent, destroy them. No. So, like a Terminator. No. So, I would say, listen, you are going to have some bad moments. And there's nothing that we can do to avoid that.
Mm-hmm.
But I would tell myself to do it all the same.
Really?
Do it all the same. Yeah. I would.
See, you're married. And I'm married. So so there's something to that.
Yeah.
Because when I was thinking about this, I thought about a previous relationship and it was a lack of trust that ended our relationship, but it wasn't over anything serious.
Right.
And I screwed up. With some downtime in her apartment and got snoopy, just bored.
Yeah.
And that it downfalled and spiraled to the point where she's like, I can't trust you in my apartment by myself.
That's right.
Like, it wasn't like I found anything damaging. It wasn't like I was looking. I was just bored. Like, But it was one of those things where, like you just said, like, those experiences truly form who we are now.
Yes.
And so I can look at things with my wife or, you know, talking to my friends and their significant others. And it's from that veil of learning. Like, if you don't trust her enough to not snoop, then you ain't in the situation you need to be in.
That's it.
And if you really feel like snooping is what you gotta do, nothing's going to be confirmed once you snoop. If you're right and some dirt's there, relationship's over.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That ain't helping.
Right.
If you were wrong, now you feel like a terrible human being because you've been meddling. Like, and that's the one thing that us as dudes value. Like, not privacy, but once I give you...
access,
like, that's a different level. That girl gave me access, and I violated that. And that's something that I've learned greatly from that lesson.
That's a good point.
I was on the opposite end of that. I walked in, got out of a shower, came in, was like, what are you doing? And it was like, oh, just looking at... No. What are you doing? No, don't stop. What are you looking at? Like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
What, nothing incriminating, things like that. And I was like, I never had a lock on my phone until that happened. And I was like, locking this.
Yeah.
Because... What are you like? Why
That's
are you
really
doing
the big
this?
Lesson. Like, it's insecurity. Like, it doesn't matter who you are or who she is. If you have enough faith in the other person,
then
you will
good.
Fight that innate desire to do whatever it is that you need to confirm it for yourself.
And you know what? That's a great point. And you know, that's funny what you guys are saying. Like, to be clear, I'm not saying don't do anything different because I did it perfect.
Yeah, that's what it sounded like to me. He was just like, run it back. Say it.
No, I'm not saying run it back, younger me.
No, he did. He battered off that bomb.
No. I was about to be like, drop the mic. No. I'm out. I'm leaving. Close my mic off. I'm done.
No, man.
Why not podcast?
No, the drink ain't got to me like that. But no, it's realizing that, you know, of course, the cliche, you wouldn't be where you are without going to blah, blah, blah. Yes, but more so than that, I mean, life could have been completely different for one or two decisions made. Yep. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
And I don't know if different is bad or good, but different is different. And I can't even wrap my mind around what the implications would be. You know what I'm saying?
So I think I'm still in the period where I'm still getting to that level. Mm-hmm. Like I'm not married. I'm single.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still finding the true things I really love and like, especially when I'm, you know, looking into another person, things like that. I'm in the dating game again. There's been some crazy mishaps.
Yeah.
Some my fault, some not my fault, and I learned lessons out of that.
Right.
I would definitely say at any period, my best advice I could give myself mm-hmm. was never bite off more than you can chew.
Mm-hmm.
And just because they say yes doesn't mean you can't plan for later. Like, so when I say that, typically, to me, it's like a 50-50 shot. If you ask somebody out, they're going to say yes or no. If they say yes, in my mind, it's like, all right, how do we seal this deal, mm-hmm. set something up as soon as possible?
Mm-hmm.
I've had the misfortune of not having the money, not having the ride, everything going wrong on a first date where I barely had enough to pay for both of us. Actually, I only had enough to pay for them.
Oh, you don't know real until you're out on the date.
Yo.
And you don't know know if that card is going to really decline or not.
It barely went through, and I had to pull some change out of some other places.
Nah.
But then I had to make life decisions because I didn't have enough to pay for gas to get back from the date.
Mine went through, but after the date went great. Overdrawn.
Hold on.
And that was back in the day. That was back in the day where they get you like.
So I ran out of gas. Coming home.
Yeah.
After I dropped them off, I ran out of gas.
Okay.
The car wouldn't start after leaving the dinner place. I didn't have enough money. I didn't have enough money to either pay for the movies.
Right.
Because I had to pay for the, like, I was like, no, I'm good. I already ate, you know, this and that. I'm just here for the conversation.
I'll take the water, if you don't mind, just extra ice.
Yeah. And by the way, dude, you look awkward. When you don't order food.
Yeah, and I realized that too.
Because everyone's insecure when they're eating. So the only thing that calms that is the other one eating too. But so if I'm staring at you while you eating that $7 chicken Caesar salad.
That looks good.
Promise you, every bite you take, I'm counting how many times that jaw moves. Like, it's a natural thing. And that's part of Brent's point. Like, he didn't want to put himself in that situation.
Yeah.
Like, he didn't want to have to act like the auspice of conversation was good enough. He was hungry too.
I was.
But he chose one over the other.
I didn't realize how awkward it was until then.
Right? Yeah.
So,
right.
Since then, I've learned to, one, if somebody's like, hey, Friday good for you? Say no if it's really not good for you. If I can't check off all the things, and we're not going to go into the whole dating thing, how much you should pay, this and that, like, because that's a whole nother conversation for a whole nother day.
Yeah.
But what it comes down to is if you value the person you're spending time with, you want to do it in a condition where you can shine as well and best as you can, but they can too.
Talk to them.
And when we're young and in our early 20s, it's too easy to try to put one person above the other. Mm. And if you do that, both people ain't walking away happy. Mm. Like us as dudes, if we're going to wine and dine but starve ourselves and drink water, when we get home, it's dang, I'm hungry. Like, it's not about how much great conversation we had. And eventually the brain keeps going even further. It's like, well, dude, she saw that I wasn't eating. So now she's thinking I'm broken. Now I got to take her some. Like, be true to who you are.
Yeah.
Stop faking the front on the thought of what the future is, because the future's not real. I hate to say it that way.
No, I mean, let's be real. That's valid.
It's not real until it happens. The only thing you control is the immediacy of a moment you're in.
Yeah.
Like, all of us as dudes, the ones that were, and this is 90s, 2000s, so like, I'm supposed to pay for your stuff. Like, chivalry, all that.
Yeah.
It's supposed to still happen now.
Up front.
Right.
100%.
Right.
But being more upfront and direct would have paid us way more dividends then. Like, baby, I feel you. Like, I'm feeling you hard.
Yeah.
But I really only got $8. So,
so I mean,
you, you get the daily double at McDonald's, I can get you the high C lemonade, and we get the fry.
Like, out of these $8, I can give you $6.
I'll eat a 10 piece nugget and starve for sure.
But I don't think
I put Sprite in a water cup for you.
That's the crazy.
But what we didn't do, we were never. That was the big thing. We were never. We never had enough confidence to be truly upfront.
Yeah.
And let's be real. As much as we were the ones trying to impress these youngins, these is young girls. They in the same boat we're in.
Right.
Like it's not like they're like, oh, you ain't gonna take me out. I just go to Ruth Chris instead.
People take advantage of chivalry. I think that's the people take advantage of chivalry. Definitely now.
Yeah.
Like
they
no one's entitled to
both,
it.
But both sexes did.
Right, right.
I'm the good guy. Look, I'll open your door. Da 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 da.
Like but I'm for that one, I don't know. Cause me, like the date I went on last week, I opened the door for her.
No, I don't mean don't open the door. No. I mean
put it later
for validation.
Yeah, I don't do it for validation. Like, I can care less if anybody sees me do this.
It's the right thing to do. That's what we were talking about earlier.
But like, I don't think it's the right thing to do. I think it's just how I would like to treat somebody who's with me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's how I would like to show certain appreciations in a...
Isn't that the right thing to do, though?
Yeah.
Like, if you feel like that's the way
people don't like their doors open.
But you know
what? Let her tell you that first, but you still got to offer that opportunity. And then when she tells you don't open my door, you can respect that. That's a different thing from saying, like,
I don't know if it's the right thing to do.
And you know what?
That's
y'all were saying the same thing.
I think we are. Yeah,
I think for me, what's interesting about the whole conversation, you know, whether she should open the door, do this, do that, it's something that I've done all along, but it wasn't until later on when I actually started thinking about it and questioning, like, what am I doing? Am I doing it for a response? Because I'll be honest, I used to open the door, and if somebody didn't say thank you,
mad.
I'm like, what was that? Yep. It's just like when you're driving, you let somebody over, they just boom, keep going.
I can't get a hand, bro. Nobody else is getting over. I get that mentality, especially if it's my bad, I didn't mean to cut you off. I get that mentality. Like, if I open the door so many times, like, and somebody's just not courteous and they, like, don't say anything. If it really bothers me, I'm not going to open your door. Like, I'll just do that. Like, I'm not going to make a fuss about it. I'll just be like, I got you. Oh, I see you behind me. You can get your own door.
Right.
You know.
Brent's ready for marriage.
I feel like... You say I'm ready for marriage?
Yeah, you're ready for marriage.
I'm just saying.
Because at a certain point...
That is, you know what I'm saying, T?
Like,
that is an OG answer.
You look at the spouse and you're like, all right, this is how you want to play it. I ain't getting I ain't doing it no more. But that's not the same thing as when you're trying to put the ring on.
Yeah.
Because everything you do wrong in that mode is damaging to you in that relationship. Mm. Once you're pot committed, like, this don't mean nothing. Like,
it's different.
It's a matriculation to a bigger issue.
Yeah, but I ain't got there.
I got to bridge that gap. Because you have enough appreciation for what's supposed to happen, but you also have enough pride in yourself to say, but I'm not going to be the freaking...
I'm not a doormat for anybody. That's just a whole, you know.
That's interesting. No, that's crazy. That's actually
crazy for me to say, though. Because think about how I started all this. Like, if I look at my 17, 18 year old self and we're like confidently, like, this is how you should act, my 17, 18 year old self would be like, what?
Like, what are you talking about? Yeah.
No, if she called me at 3 a.m. too drunk, I'm going to go pick her up. I'm going to take her home. I'm going to hold her hair while she's puking. And when she passes out, I'm going home. And then tomorrow, like, dude, bro, friend zone wasn't a thing when I was in high school. But if it was, I would have realized very quickly that's what I was setting myself up for.
Yeah.
Like, I was not flexing who I was. I was just trying to fill in a gap. Oh, you got daddy issues? I'll support. But never, like, cross that line to be rude. Like, and that's the reality of it. Like, if you got enough confidence in who you are, like, I can be your friend.
Yeah.
I can be what you need, but I can still be me.
Yeah.
And so if it doesn't work after 20 minutes, you feel better. I'm glad you feel better, but
I'm out. Peace.
Someone over there.
Peace.
From your high school.
I would have invested 3 hours in that one.
You could have slid in there. Yep.
Well, yeah, and that's... Now, listen.
After high school?
It's also, with this question... Right. With this question, it's also like that meme with the evil Kermit with the hood.
100%.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, because I could tell younger self,
be a
couple
savage.
More tricks.
Yep. Yo, be a savage, B.
Things can be different.
You want the bad Kermit?
Right.
You want to do that? You want to do this on the Why Not For Real?
Yeah,
bad Kermit. Yo, B. Be a savage. Like,
yeah, but don't. Come on back.
You had a party? You know, girl didn't holler? She wasn't feeling it? I guarantee you three you can take home. Just keep going. Just keep working.
Just to prove the other one that
go away.
But that's a savage.
Why aren't you shooting them shots?
But hold on. Yeah. But there's a reason that all of us, because we knew that at 17.
Sure.
Like, none of us were ever... I'm going to bat 100. I'm going to take shots at 10 girls. If I can hold with one, I win. Like, that wasn't our mentality.
Yeah,
and so to say it now at 34, like, we know we wouldn't tell our past selves that. What we would tell them is more of a, it's a more moderate discussion. Don't sell out for the ones that you know you ain't ever going to get.
Focus on quality. Right?
But appreciate the ones when the moment presents itself that are genuine. Because that's really what you're really saying. Like, if the door opens, walk through it. But you ain't got to kick every door open.
Man. No kicking doors. Man. Just walk through open doors.
Listen.
Shouts out to young me.
Me and Brent didn't realize the doors were open. Teddy was in there like, hey, yo, girl.
Yeah, right.
Talk to you a little bit later.
You know what? And on that note, I'm very happy.
This is good.
I'm very happy to be here. Very happy to be here. Man, great show, fellas. Great show. I appreciate y'all coming through, literally coming through and kicking it with me. And
thanks for the invite, man.
Yeah, man. Traveling to the creek, Fern Creek. Shout out to that. And you know, we make do. So when people hear the show and they want to reach out to you, starting with Pack, how would they do that, sir?
All right. You get me on Twitter on rpack1. I don't tweet a lot, but I respond to anything that comes to me because I feel like that's important. On Instagram, it's r_packville. If you want to see pictures of my wife, my shoes, my kids, my food.
All those fun things.
Right. Because my social media, and this is one of those lessons as a teacher, like there's a very clear differentiation. Like, who I am in real life is not who I am on social media.
No.
I could say, but what a lot of y'all youngsters do is go extreme negative on social media because it's not who you are in real life. I go the other way. My shit's my stuff is daffodils and roses.
Like daffodils and roses.
I'm not rocking boats. I'm not doing any of that. Yeah. But if you want to get to know me on that, we can have genuine conversations. And all I'm trying to do is uplift and make people move forward.
I like it, man. And also, if they wanted to hear you on podcast, where were they?
Wrap Up Podcast. We coming back in like 4 weeks now. Oh, Game of Thrones. My second kid is doing 5. Yeah. But I'm telling y'all right now, here's how much I believe in this Wrap Up and Game of Thrones. I ain't missing an episode this year. I don't care if y'all gonna have to hear the crying baby in the background.
Amen. Bro, that's
this
what they make
about to get really real.
That's what they make mute buttons for. Right. It's all good.
But
it's
I'm not good at those. I be peeing in jars and people. Anyway, y'all can find me on social media. I just claim that. LJ, you didn't hear that. Brent.
Hey, Brent. You can find me on pretty much all social media at LLCOOLB22, LLCoolB22. That's Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, whatever. You put it in there and figure out where you find me at. You can also find me at the OAF Discussions podcast, OAFDiscussions.com.
Also a group on Facebook, right?
There is a Facebook group. Search OAF Discussions podcast and join the group.
There you go.
Have some fun with us.
Before Teddy ends this right, I'm just going to say this.
Yeah.
The African-American podcast community in this area is growing, and it's a valid community.
Yeah.
This man on Why Not has had Brett. You know, she's had Red. Like the diversity of what we're doing, OAF with Brent and them. Like, the crew's growing, and it's growing with the stream of consciousness that's only meant for improvement.
Yeah.
So those of y'all that are listening, let your friends know what we're doing, because we ain't trying to sun you. We ain't trying to bring you down. All we're trying to do is move the culture forward.
And I show love all day. Like, if you got a podcast, shoot it to me. I'll listen to it.
Yeah, man.
You want feedback, let me know. Like,
let's grow this, because we've got a market in this area that is Teddy and Brent are really starting to tap into. LJ too. Lish, all of y'all. Like, we got to keep it going, though, because there's so much growth that I even see personally as a teacher in terms of our culture from this sort of avenue. People being completely genuine, completely authentic, sometimes a little self-deprecating, but under the grain of you're going to learn what we've learned from Hard Knocks.
Right. Like,
that was really kind of what the show was.
Yeah. Right.
Our Hard Knocks are so you can soft knock that and kick the door down.
That's real, man. Laugh at us so you can avoid it. That's
there
real.
It is.
That's real. So, man, great show. Listen, I'm proud of y'all, brothers. Keep on doing the good work. I appreciate y'all coming through, and feel free to reach out. Teddy_D_ on Twitter. The homie Kai Love used to say.
Shout out to exactly how she said.
On the Twitter.
Shout out, Kai.
Also, reach out on Facebook, the Black Astronauts Network page, and of course, Black Astronauts, Patreon/Black Astronauts. You can feel free to reach out on that as well. Listen, we have some great shows lined up, and I guarantee you will enjoy it. And for everyone who's reached out and listened, I appreciate it. I'll figure out the feedback somehow, and I'll let you know how we'll do it.
Just at Brent.
Right.
Just at LL, and I'll comment to you. You know, if you want to talk about single life relationships,
so be it.
Just get at me.
That's what's up.
I got you.
That's what's up. I appreciate it. So from the great city of Louisville, the not so great state of Kentucky, this is Teddy D. Bevin, you're the worst.
Rand Paul, Mitch McConnell.
And Rand Paul. Is that the holy trinity of horrible politicians? Bevin, Rand Paul, and Mitch McConnell? Anyways,
it's pretty close.
What are we doing, Kentucky? Wow. All right. Thanks for joining us, y'all. We'll see you next show. Peace.
Be good or be good at it.
First things first, I'm going to say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, my sea, oh, ooh, the master of my sea, oh, ooh. I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took to me, shook at me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty